A lot of people don't know that we actually do get earthquakes here in Oregon. And one of our main hazards from earthquakes is the Cascadia Subduction Zone. How many people here have heard of Cascadia? And this is really our existential hazard here in Oregon. And we have two very good examples in the past decade or so of what we can expect to see here in Oregon from a Cascadia Subduction Zone earthquake. The 2004 Indonesian earthquake and tsunami, and then again Japan 2011 earthquake and tsunami. If we look at Oregon and compare it to Japan, it's about the same size. And the thing to remember about the Cascadia Subduction Zone is it runs from Northern California, about Crescent City, all the way up to the northern end of Vancouver Island. So when this happens, if we get the full rip 9, we're expecting shaking from Northern California all the way up to British Columbia. And you're going to be able to feel this in Eastern Oregon. There are some models that show building collapse in Baker City. So even though the hazard is right off the coast, it will impact the entire state. Trying to remember which slides I added to this. So it runs about 600 miles, and it dives at a fairly shallow depth, and the subduction zone ends where the Cascade Mountains are. In fact, the Cascade Mountains are the volcanoes caused by the subduction going down about 100 miles, melting, coming up through cracks in the earth, and giving those beautiful mountains that we like to hike on in the summer, ski on in the winter. So that system is all connected. Now, a Cascadia Subduction Zone earthquake will not cause a volcano to erupt unless that volcano is already ramped up and just about to blow. There's a very, 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 very small chance that Cascadia could cause that volcano to blow. But we don't have any currently endangered volcanoes here in Oregon. It also will not cause the crustal faults that we have here in Oregon. Those are the smaller intraplate faults that we have. Anybody remember the Scotts Mills earthquake in 93? That's a crustal fault. Portland has a crustal fault that runs along Forest Park that can cause an earthquake up to about a 7.2. So we don't have just a Cascadia subduction zone, but we do have these crustal faults also. When we look at the subduction zones and you think about these other very, very large earthquakes around the rest of the world, those are almost always subduction zones because it takes a very large fault system to create a very large earthquake. In fact, it's a direct relation. The size of the fault limits how big an earthquake can get. We cannot get, no matter what Hollywood says, we cannot get a 10.5 because we just don't have fault systems large enough to produce those size of earthquakes. Now, right after the earthquake, we know that this is going to also produce a very devastating tsunami. About 90 to 95% of the deaths and injuries will come from that tsunami. There will be actually fairly limited death in the valley from this earthquake. We will have some collapsing buildings. We will have some injuries. But the majority of the deaths are going to come in that first hour from the tsunami. This is what we see in almost every single large subduction zone earthquake, no matter where they happen in the world. And the thing to remember about tsunamis is they are covered by flood insurance. So if you live in the inundation zone on the coast, get flood insurance because it will cover you for that tsunami loss. And so one of the questions that we get asked is, you know, how often and what's the likelihood of these earthquakes? Because other hazards, we get every single year. We get fires every single year. We get winter storms every single year. We get floods every single year. Well, it's hundreds of years between these large earthquakes. Our last subduction zone earthquake for Cascadia was in 1700. In fact, it was January 26th at 9 p.m. in the year 1700. And we've had over 40 of these large earthquakes in the last 10,000 years. And so when they start to look at this, they break it down between large 100% ruptures, you know, the full rip 9, but it can also get smaller earthquakes. And what they're finding is those smaller earthquakes either start at the very northern end or the very southern end of the subduction zone. So when you hear about probabilities, you might hear 37 or 40% or 12% or 14%. Well, all of those numbers are true for a specific scenario. So if you're sitting in Bandon, Oregon, enjoying a cup of coffee down on that pier waiting for your crab to cook, you've got a 37 to 40% chance in the next 50 years of a subduction zone earthquake happening. If you are sitting in Ilwaco waiting for your charter boat to get ready so you can go out, you have about a 14% chance because of the way that that subduction zone works. So numbers on probability are interesting, but they're not the important number. The important number is 100%. We know that 100% we will be getting another Cascadia subduction zone earthquake at some point in the future, probably within the next 50 years. And so we know that this is something that we have to prepare for. And this is the big bad. If you get prepared for Cascadia, you are going to be ready for all of these other hazards that we have. So when we look at this, that shaking is going to be happening from Northern California all the way up to British Columbia, all the way inland. They're expecting it to take the power grid down for the western U.S., at least for a day or two until they're able to get that power balance. Because not only are you losing power production along the Columbia and Snake River and the various natural gas coal-powered plants in the Pacific Northwest, but you also have that sudden reduction in usage. So it takes time to rebalance that utility. And the thing to remember is that this is not a one-and-done event. Cascadia will start a really a new way of living here in the Pacific Northwest. A common issue with these large events is PTSD, because we're going to be awesome that first week. We all are going to have some supplies. We're going to pool our supplies with our neighbors. And we're going to get through that first few weeks, that second week, that third week, that fourth week. You haven't had a shower. You're not going to have a shower for probably another few weeks. Your water, your power is going to be out, depending on where you are, for 1 to 2 years. It weighs on a person. And so just knowing that this will really be a change in lifestyle here in the Pacific Northwest. And when you are choosing to get prepared or choosing not to get to be prepared, you're choosing one major thing. Are you going to be an Oregonian after this event? Because we've all seen large-scale natural disasters that has caused a diaspora. And that's because the people aren't able to have a job or send their kids to school, power, water, or just have the resources in that area. Think about Katrina after that event. And so you're choosing to stay Oregonian, choosing to stay in your home, choosing to be an asset and a resource to your neighbors and to your families, or you're choosing to be a burden on society. Because if you can't take care of yourself, you will be sent somewhere that you can be taken care of. And that's going to be in Oklahoma or Ohio. Now, I've been to Oklahoma and I've been to Ohio. You want to be able to stay here in Oregon because it's much prettier here. Nothing against Oklahoma and Ohio. But that's the choice you're making. Are you going to be an asset? Are you going to be a resource? Are you going to be someone that's going to participate in rebuilding Oregon? Or are you going to go somewhere else? And that's the choice you make when you look at your grocery cart and you don't put that extra water in there. It's a choice you're making whether you take action or not. Every action is a choice. Every inaction is a choice. So make that choice to be a part of the recovery and getting Oregon back to the Oregon that we love.
Yeah, wow. That was very motivating. I feel like we should just drop the mic and walk out on that, but we do have a couple more questions. Does your homeowner's insurance policy cover earthquake damage?
Like Althea said, homeowners does not, in most cases, cover earthquake insurance. Say 99% of the time it does not. There are a few out there that will. There's like mobile homes. Again, check with your insurance company, but 99% of the time it does not. Earthquake insurance is expensive. In many cases, it can almost double what you pay now for your homeowners insurance. And the deductibles are very high. It's often a percentage. So we recommend, if you do have earthquake insurance, to have maybe a home equity line or something that you could pull on to help cover the cost for that deductible. Now, in that situation, it's not first money. You don't have to pay $30,000 to get your house fixed, which is often kind of about where the deductibles will lie for most homes in Oregon. But what that means is you'll just be underinsured. The other thing to consider as well with earthquake insurance is that if the earthquake does not meet the threshold of damage that exceeds your deductible, it won't pay. So if we have one of these crustal faults that maybe does $15,000 in damage and you have a $30,000 deductible, it won't pay. You're gonna have to pay that $15,000 out of pocket to get your house fixed. And it's each earthquake is its own beast. So if there's an earthquake that does $15,000 in damage, and then 3 months later, there's one that does another $15,000. Hey, that's $30,000. Your insurance company doesn't care. That's just another $15,000 quake. They don't aggregate. So it's all independent. So that's something else to consider. The other thing also is retrofitting. If you don't want to buy earthquake insurance, perhaps reduce your risk to damage to your home by retrofitting. And there's lots of companies, especially in Oregon, that are trying to help people get prepared for earthquake insurance. And I'm going to just steal the mic a little bit longer. If you live in the inundation zone, flood insurance will be great. You probably don't need earthquake insurance because your house is going to be leveled by the earthquake and then the flood as well. So flood insurance might be a better option than earthquake if you live in that inundation zone. That's and it's also tip. Very difficult to get earthquake insurance mm-hmm. on the coast.
That makes sense.
So I just want to piggyback on the retrofitting. If your house has been built since about 2000, it's probably up to the most recent seismic codes. But remember, building codes only mean that that building will not fall down. It doesn't mean that that building will be at all usable after the earthquake. So if you want to be able to go into that home, you will need to add additional seismic retrofitting. And seismic retrofitting is surprisingly affordable if you don't have, you know, a huge home. If you have your standard ranch home, like we have a lot here in Oregon, you're going to spend more on a granite countertop for a kitchen remodel than you will for a seismic retrofit. And if you're at all handy and do a lot of your own renovations, there's a lot of information online from FEMA. If you just go Google FEMA seismic homeowner retrofit, there's a great publication that you can download, and you can probably retrofit 90 to 95% of your house yourself if you're at all handy.
Wow, thank you.
And I can vouch for it being cheaper than you would think. I just had my house bolted to its foundation.
Wow, great. So you took one of those steps. We have a question from the audience.
Is this building retrofitted?
Anyone from facilities? I don't know the answer to that. I know that the state has been doing, yeah. I sit up on the fourth floor, so we get to write it down if it happens. So I don't know the answer to that, but that's a great question to ask your employer if you feel concerned about that and know your evacuation zones, what are likely to fail. I believe in these buildings around the Capitol Mall that have the granite on the sides, they don't want you to leave during a shake because they could fall. And I know that the Capitol they've been talking about, I don't know if that's what they're working on now with some seismic work on there, but they've been trying to pin that granite to the building because it's a lot of them are held on by glue. If you can believe it. So glue works for tile, but they can come down.
Well, that's good to know. Thank you. I would love to end on the note of somebody being willing to be brave and share one step they're going to take today or tomorrow to be more prepared for a potential emergency. Does any brave person? Okay, we have
I'm gonna put the shoes beside my bed and the gloves and the flashlight and make everybody in the house do the same thing.
Shoes beside the bed, there you go. Anybody else want to share? Yes. Wonderful. Wonderful. Well, you all did your job then. You have two converts, at least. Myself included, you have three, definitely. So thank you so much. Let's give our panelists a round of applause.
Thank you.